I don't do magic tricks. I help companies build brand value and great reputations. Ladies and gentlemen, let me take you into a small office 5 minutes away from the modern city in Beijing. There, as we said, I was the PR director in the Shangri-La group for 5 years. I had to turn a forgotten 20-year-old hotel into the talk of the town. So tonight I would like to share with you what has been called one of the most innovative MICE programs of the decade. I'm proud to say that it was my brainchild. MICE is an acronym for Meetings, Incentives, Conventions and Events. I would also like to share how I found the key to overcome obstacles and unlock the doors of the Forbidden City to implement this program. Can I have a show of hands? Who has worked with people who are considered complacent and allergic to change? Thank you. Many people describe my team, my former team, like that. They existed in a time warp of a golden era when customers begged to do business with them. Business, in fact, was going to new luxury hotels. They were sexy, they had cutting-edge facilities, and they had killer hungry teams. We, however, had a team and a hotel with a time-honored reputation as a preferred events venue. It had a monolithic amount of convention space. For 3 straight years, it hosted over 700 meetings every year. And that's a lot by the standards of big convention hotels. So I decided to use this resource to create an initiative to benefit the people, planet, and profit. And so began the Carbonless Meeting Program, CMP in short. With this, meeting organizers could host elegant and luxurious meetings with a greener setup that quantifies CO2 emissions. 2% of the revenue from these meetings goes towards education for the underprivileged. And because they chose this socially responsible option, the hotel presents the organizer with a personalized scroll of thanks in the presence of all delegates at the end of the event. I have samples and images to show later if you want to have a look. It's an all-round, do-good, feel-good brand-building event. By swapping water, fuel, and energy-intensive resources for more environmentally friendly options, meetings held with the CMP reduce over 1 metric ton of CO2 emissions in a 3-day meeting for 30 people. That, ladies and gentlemen, is equivalent to the amount absorbed by 60 trees. So for a start, I wanted just 10% of these meetings 10% of the projected 700 meetings to be held with the CMP. We could then reduce at least 25,000 tons of emissions and sponsor 5 children a year to middle school. I was so excited. I had spent so many months of my personal time to put this program together and consulted the experts, negotiated, and also sought approvals, and I just could not wait to get this program off the road. With the external stakeholders, it was a hit. Jack Morton's international brand consultants raved that Shangri-La invents new experiences that invite participation, experiences that people want to share. My excitement, however, was short-lived. All our internal people objected. It was no use giving them explanations like this was a holistic win-win proposition, that it would return us back to a golden era of demand exceeding supply, or that it would position us as preferred supplier, or that it's just simply a matter of reorganizing resources. Nothing worked. The sales department advised customers against it. Our financial controller objected to 2% being given away. The operations department didn't even bother to mock up a greener setup. I felt like the last Emperor Puyi, when the big red doors closed in his face at the city. And like Puyi, when he called for a morning meeting and no eunuchs showed, many Ephesians did not show up for my implementation meeting. So left alone like the last emperor in his deserted palace, I realized that I had built or had not built the motivational bridges to help my team cross the deep, dark fear of change. And then on deeper reflection, I also realized that I first had to change before I could expect others to change. I had excluded them from discussions or plans to change because I was afraid that they would derail me or that they would inconvenience me. And I dumped my expectations on them and arrogantly expected them to do what I wanted without sharing in ways that they could appreciate how this could benefit them. I also forgot to seek their approval in the way that I had sought everybody else's. So, what would you do in my shoes? To say that I didn't cry would be a lie. I wallowed in self-pity. But I knew that I had to get back to the drawing board to rework my internal communication strategy and rethink my interface with the various divisions. I intended to start the Red Revolution in the hotel. So on my next presentation to the financial controller, I emphasized the projected monetary savings from the CMP. That amount, I said, would far exceed the sum of 2% to be allocated to education. So No further issues about 2% after that. With the sales department, we gave them incentives and a lot more arm twisting, of course. And several meetings later with raving customer reviews, the operations departments started taking ownership of the program. They even started telling me how to do a greener setup. So I'm glad that this lady from a little red dot could make a positive impact in the bigger red dot without any red bloodshed. And whilst I didn't banish the Forbidden City, I broke out of the illusions that stood in the way of my goals. That is, to lead others in change, I first must change. Be like Puyi, who resisted change, to become the last emperor of China. Mr. Moderator.
Thank you.